Welcome to RSA. My name is Yogesh Badwe. I'm the Director of Security at Okta, responsible for Okta's prevention, detection, and response strategy. And today, we are going to talk about what things to keep in mind before launching your bug bounty program. We are also going to derive some insight from some of the data we have collected over the last 3 years of running a bug bounty program. So let's get started. It is very easy to launch a bug bounty program. It is, however, much harder to derive measurable value from that bug bounty program. Deriving measurable value does get easier if you apply basic management principles of defining goals, identifying strategies, and tracking metrics to your program. So let's look at goals. So why do you need goals? For your efforts and investments in a bug bounty program to provide the desired results or value, it is crucial that you start the process by first identifying what you want to achieve from the program. So what you might want to achieve? You might be looking at a bug bounty for external validation of your internal security efforts. Or maybe you are looking at resource augmentation for your smaller internal team. Maybe you want to find bugs at a cheaper cost and have some cost savings. Or maybe you are just looking to have a disclosure channel in place so that you can communicate to the researcher community and the researcher community can communicate back to you. Regardless of the type or number of goals you have, it is important to formalize them at the very beginning, because they will provide focus and direction to your efforts. And they will also help you to track the success and failure of your program. But it is not enough to just formalize goals. You also need to think about and implement strategies that can help you achieve those goals. And you will have a lot of questions to answer. For example, should you go with a public program or a private program? What should be the payout range of your bug bounty program? How much do you need to pay for each individual type of bug? Now, answer to some of these questions will depend on the goals you choose. But these questions are also levers that you can tweak to affect the program outcome. At Okta, over the last 3+ years, we collected a lot of data across various configurations. Let's look at that data and see if we can answer some of these questions. The type of program to have. To answer this question, we are going to look at 3 key decision variables. Number 1, what is the value you want to derive from the program? Number 2, whether you are okay with the noise generated on the program. And number 3, whether you want to invest your time and effort in generating activity or buzz on the program. Now, looking at our data and keeping the number of researchers and duration the same, we saw more valid submissions on the public program than on the private program. However, we also saw a lot more total submissions in the public program, which means there were a lot more false positives. So thinking about our decision variables, if you do not care about false positives and you do not want to invest time and effort in generating activity, then a public program might provide you with the right amount of value. But all of us do care about false positives, because noise means man hours spent trying to parse through that noise. Again, looking at the average rate of submissions and the total submissions across both the public and private program, and doing some simple goal seeking, we saw that it is possible to achieve the same throughput in a private program with a lot less noise, provided you are ready to invest time and effort in generating activity or buzz on your program. So thinking about our decision variables, a private program might be right suited for you if you are ready to invest time and effort in generating activity. But it is important to keep in mind that if you are a small company or if you don't have a well-known brand or product, it is very difficult to generate activity within the researcher community for your program. But valid submissions is not always true value, right? Because you can have a lot of valid submissions that are low severity. Maybe what you're looking for is impactful submissions. And the biggest indicator of an impact of a submission is the amount of money you are paying out. Again, thinking about the average submissions per month, both valid and total, and comparing them with the average payouts that we were giving out, we saw a lot more impactful submissions in the public program than we saw in the private program. So it is important to keep all of these factors in mind when you are thinking about what type of program to go for. The payout range. Now, there are bug bounty programs out there by large companies with huge payout ranges. There are also bug bounty programs out there that don't pay any money, but still generate a lot of interest from the researcher community. Once you carefully identify the type of program to have, you will have to spend some time trying to understand what type of payout range that you can put out. Over multiple points in time over the last 3 years, we kept all the other variables the same, but changed the upper bound of our payout range. These changes had negligible impact on the count of submissions received. As a matter of fact, changing the upper bound or increasing the upper bound by a multiple of 3 or more did not even result in a change of twice the amount of valid submissions we were receiving. So count of submissions is not sensitive to the upper bound of your payout range. Carefully see what works best for you. On the other hand, looking at our data, the count of submissions is very sensitive to the lower bound of your payout range. So if you want more valid submissions, maybe increasing your lowermost bound can give you that value. But do you really want to pay a lot of money for low severity submissions? Probably not. Carefully think about what is the right payout range for you and find the fine balance. You need to keep your payout range respectful, but there is no need to go chasing big payout ranges by bigger companies. Now we talked about goals and tried to answer some questions that can help us identify the right strategy for us. But even that is not enough. We need to spend some time internally planning before we launch a bug bounty program. And there are a lot of things to consider. We are not going to cover all of those in this smaller talk, but let's look at what are the top three or four things that we might want to consider. Number one, you need to have a vulnerability management process in place. There is no easy way to say this. If you can't get your internal teams to fix bugs or fix bugs in time, there is no reason to go out looking for more bugs. Number two, get internal buy-in. Now, a bug bounty program is going to touch various parts of your organization, from engineering to site operations, or even marketing, PR, and legal. It is important for you before the launch to spend some time and get these teams on board with your initiatives. Number three, the rules of the game. Arguably, the landing page is the most important document that you will write. It guides the researchers into what they should be doing. Spend some time in trying to use the landing page to guide the researchers into what you want them to test and away from what you don't want them to test. And finally, define metrics early. Again, there is no easy way to go back in time and collect the data that you want for tracking the success and failure of your program. Now, we thought about some goals and implemented some strategies to get a lot of submissions. But we can get a lot of submissions even if we invest in our internal teams. So what exactly is the return on investment of a bug bounty program? A lot of the ROI for most of the goals is going to be achieved for you by just having a bug bounty program in place. But a few of them, such as resource augmentation or cost savings, would need further analysis. Security teams usually have finite budgets, so it is important to think about the ROI of a bug bounty program to make the right investment decision. Let's look at resource augmentation. When we think about resource augmentation, essentially, we are talking about headcount. Now, a typical bug bounty program out there, it is very normal to have hundreds of researchers sign up to test your program. But that does not directly translate into headcount. To answer this question, we had three pieces of data. We had the logs generated in the back end by researchers testing our product. We did multiple surveys over the last 3 years to understand the approach and behavior of researchers. And we also had the typical metadata about the program, for example, the type of the program, the number of valid submissions, et cetera. We used all of this data and analyzed it to estimate the average amount of time a researcher spends testing our product. Then we used that to estimate the total testing hours spent on our program, and then compared it and contrasted it with the public program versus the private program. Interestingly, through the public program, we received a lot more headcount worth of testing done. But when we compared it with the valid submissions we received, the private program was much more efficient in terms of the number of submissions per headcount. Regardless of whether the private program is better or the public program, as a decision maker for you, both of these are going to provide significant amount of resource augmentation. Let's look at cost savings. Now, it is very hard to identify the cost of a bug. It is even harder to identify the cost of not finding a bug. So instead, we decided to look at the cost of trying to find a bug. Now, there are multiple avenues for trying to find a bug. For example, you can obviously go and have a bug bounty program. You can enhance your internal team. You can outsource that work to local or offshore consulting firms. Looking at our data, we identified that the cost of finding a bug for us came out to around $25 an hour, which was much cheaper than all the other options out there. Granted that this does not take care or consider the quality of submissions or the quality of resources that are testing your product. But a bug bounty program is definitely a cheaper option, at least for us. It is important to keep in mind that this was specific to our case and our environment. And it's going to be different depending on your state of maturity. The bug bounty program is only cheap if you have a lot of researchers participating in your program. The bug bounty program is also only going to be cheap if you do not expect a lot of impactful submissions to be part of the bug bounty program. But wait, that is ironic, because the whole point of a bug bounty program is to have a lot of impactful submissions. I will let you think about that later. So to recap, if you are planning to launch a bug bounty program, first and foremost, define what you want to achieve from the program. Number two, identify what budget you have to play with, because that is going to impact a lot of different things. Number three, use the budget and your goals to identify and implement strategies that can help you achieve those goals within that budget. Spend some time planning and look at all the different things that we talked about before launching the program. And number five, make sure that you identify metrics and keep a track of ROI for your bug bounty program as you go along. Thank you.